I want to first commend you for all the work that you've done in regards to the opioid crisis in our Commonwealth and the Centers for Excellence. However, it gives me pause, and I would be remiss if I did not think about and talk about other drug epidemics in our country's history, and particularly the crack cocaine epidemic of the 80s, and if we go generations back to the heroin epidemic of the 60s and 70s that largely impacted communities of color. And the response to those epidemics were quite different than what we see today, in which we responded with a war on drugs and criminalized and punished addicts. I can appreciate today's compassion. I can appreciate the societal shift in which we are looking at this crisis now. But I do not and cannot ignore the fact that now we are looking at a crisis in which the addict's face is mostly white. That being said, I'd like to know if what programs and services and attention we are still giving to those drug addictions that may not be at the forefront right now, may not be quote-unquote sexy of the moment, but yet we have communities that still may be suffering from those addictions, and whether or not we are still addressing those issues.
Certainly. Thank you for that question. And again, I'm going to turn our attention momentarily, at least, to the 21st Century Cures Act grant that we are anticipating receiving. And some of the money in that grant is designed, from Pennsylvania's perspective, to look at some of our special populations here in Pennsylvania. And by special populations, I mean a couple of different things. So women and women with children would be considered a special population. Veterans would be considered a special population. But in particular, two areas of focus that we plan to have are on our Latino population as well as our Bhutanese population. These are two that have really come to the forefront in recent months in terms of not having treatment facilities that can accommodate the needs of those special populations. And so what's happening in those areas is that the needs are going completely unmet, and folks are unwilling to even seek out treatment, let alone attempt a successful completion of it. So we do anticipate utilizing some of that grant funding to address those two specific populations. We're always trying to keep a pulse on where we see the epidemic hitting the hardest. And so if there are additional populations that you would like to speak with us about or have us consider special types of treatment or services, I would welcome those conversations with you.
Thank you. As a follow-up question, we know that for many patients, whether they be addicts or otherwise, are in order for them to seek that treatment, they often seek treatment from folks they can relate to, whether it be culturally or language. Some of our areas are medically underserved areas. What programs, for example, the FIA loan program, are in place to serve those populations and bring professionals into those populations that look like them, that can relate to them culturally or linguistically? And also, if you have time, please share. If not, if you can share with me later the numbers and diversity in your staff as well.
Sure. So I can take a start at the question in terms of what are we doing to meet those needs. And one area in particular, and again, we're working with the Latino population specifically, is in workforce development. And so how do we get individuals of the Latino population who have successfully completed treatment and are living a life of recovery, how do we get them engaged in the process of becoming a certified recovery specialist? And for those of you that don't know, a certified recovery specialist is someone who is living their life in recovery, who decides to give back to the profession and works with individuals to assist them in getting into treatment and working through treatment, and they have that lived experience to bring to the table. So that's an area that we're working very closely with that population because of the language barrier, because of some educational requirements necessary to obtain that certification. We know there are a lot of struggles. So we have been partnering with several Latino community organizations as well as HAC on how we can work to overcome some of those educational challenges and language barriers. I don't know if Dr. Levine may have anything to add on that.
One of the other populations that we'd like to reach out to LGBT population, including a significantly underserved population, which is LGBT individuals of color, particularly in the Philadelphia area and major cities, which have, because of discrimination, have significant risks of substance abuse in general, opioids and other substances, and have very little services.
Great, thank you, and I appreciate you pointing out the LGBT community of color in particular and their needs as well. I thank you for your response, and if you can share with me later your diversity numbers and your staff, I don't want to take up any more of the committee's time with that. Thank you.